It is with such joy and excitement that I get to welcome all of you today. We are working hard to make our virtual presentations as good as we can. Please feel free to give us criticisms, or no, not criticisms, give us critiques. And Pastor Karen is always available, well, to talk to you, or will return your calls if you call the church office and she doesn't happen to be there. So do, call her. She told me she wants you to call her. I have some prayer requests. I have some announcements. Prayer requests is the top of the announcements. We need to have your prayer requests. You always have prayer requests. Call the church office. Leave them in the office. Call Pastor Karen. Leave them with Pastor Karen. They'll get on our prayer chain that's on email. We will announce them here. Pastor Karen will put them in her prayer. And I can add a joy for you that on Tuesday, Bob and I will be celebrating our 48th wedding anniversary. By ourselves, because the kids don't want to be with us. All right, connection in the community. This is a very vital, important church, and we move around this community. But Pastor Karen is new to us, and she would like to know what you do. So could you call her or send her emails and let her know what it is that you do? Do you work at CRCC? Do you work at the community food center? What do you do? Where are you in vital presence in the community? Speaking of vital presence, in July we had the food drive where a group of people collected food out in the parking lot. We are going to do that again in August. We think we're going to do that every other month because the Community Resource Center, I think it is, where we take the food, really needs the food because there are a lot of people in need right now. I talked to Sandy Cram, the director of preschool. With the shutdown and the school having to be shut down, parents are afraid. She needs 5 more students so she can open the preschool in the fall. If you don't know about our preschool, this is an amazing preschool. Both of my children went through this preschool. It is, they play, they teach, they do all kinds of wonderful things and are directed towards what the children's age levels are. So if you know somebody that's looking for a preschool, have them call the United Methodist Preschool. It's really a good quality school. And I think that is exactly what my announcement list says. So would you please be in an attitude of prayer as we do the call to worship? Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep testimonies, who seek God with their whole heart, who also do no wrong, but walk in God's ways. You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes. Then I shall not be put to shame, having my eyes fixed on all your commandments. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous ordinance. I will observe your statutes. Oh, forsake me, not utterly.
Good morning and welcome to La Habra United Methodist Church. We're so happy to have you with us for our worship service today. We're working, as Janelle said, on perfecting this. And so, as she said, please call us, let us know. We're hoping the sound today will be much better than our first attempt last week. So we're here to bless, to hold you in our prayers, and we're offering that truth in the gospel each and every time we share. Why don't we pray now as we begin our service? Gracious Lord, we thank you for this time together, whether home or here. Lord, we're so blessed to have you as our King and our Savior. Lord, we turn this time to you, and we ask that your blessings would be upon the word and the song, the music and the prayer. Lord, thank you for blessing us with this building, and Lord, we know in time we will be together again. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you. reminded that even while we are apart, we are obligated to support the ministry of our church. I'm excited that we can celebrate together, even when we're in our own homes or wherever we may be watching. But I encourage you, take your giving envelope and drop it by the church, drop it in the mail. We're happy and grateful that you have remembered to support this ministry, even while we're separated. Let me pray for this offering. Gracious God, we thank you for the gift and the givers. Lord, we know that in times of distress, you've been faithful to fill in the margin. Lord, we ask that you take these gifts and these offerings and that you stretch them and that they be used for the ministry of the gospel in this city, in our church and in our community. Lord, make us recipients of your blessing that we might understand how we can best give. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Prayer is the most important thing a Christian can do. We are aware that in this time of distress in our country and in our world, prayer is the thing that keeps us faithful to our relationship with Jesus. I invite you now, wherever you may be, whether you're sitting at home, maybe you're sitting in your office, maybe you're even in your car listening to this, let's take a moment, let's bow our heads, and let's ask the Holy Spirit to come into our hearts and inform our minds of your love. Let us pray. Gracious God, you come into our lives, into our hearts in so many ways, through the people we know, through the community, through our relationships, through music, through prayer. Lord, allow us to find centering moments each day, throughout our day, that we might be people of prayer. Lord, it says in Scripture that we should fall to our knees and pray without ceasing, that you might come and intercede for us through your Spirit. Lord, we're aware of some in our community that are struggling with illness. We think of Michael and his family. We're holding them in our prayers. We're thinking of those that are having procedures. We know that some have just received some news and those that have received good news. And Lord, we know that each and every one needs your healing hand. Lord, we trust you as the great physician, and we know that in your power we are healed. Lord, we're also aware that those may be grieving, not only the loss of our dear pastor, but the loss of friends, relatives, those that we may not know to this virus. Lord, we know that your skill and your hands and your science come through our wonderful physicians, nurses, and technicians. Bless them, God, as they care for those that are sick. Lord, you told us to come to you and just touch the hem of your garment that we might be healed. So, Lord, may your grace fall upon us. May your blessings encourage us, and may your strength sustain us. Let us pray together wherever we may be, that prayer you taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We begin today reading some scriptures that teach us about growing, about reaping, about sowing. about harvest. Jesus taught his people in parable. And so we begin today with the parable of the sower. And that same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables and said, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path. And the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil. And they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched. And since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen." Jesus goes on in Matthew and later in this chapter, and he talks about the meaning of his parable. He says, "Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does it, and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what is sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what is sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So first, I wanted to ask, has anyone done their homework? You may remember last Sunday, I asked you to work on a homework project. Now, I will confess that throughout the week, I have asked a few of the members who've stopped in the office if they were able to accomplish it. And I was pleased and surprised to hear some really amazing stories of people who had decided to take up that homework assignment. And it's wonderful when people are blessed by just listening to hear the phone ring, the God call, the call that says, "Come and do this task today." Maybe it's a new project. In some cases, it was a phone call to a loved one or a note. In other cases, I heard people share that they had received an act of kindness from another member of the congregation. These are the ways that we respond to the call of faith. Each and every day, God has got a plan for us. He's got a mission for us. He's got a challenge, a new opportunity. So I encourage you, continue that homework assignment as we go forward. Will you pray with me now? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts together be acceptable in your sight. God, you are our Redeemer and our Sustainer. Amen. So, as I was leaving my just prior church, one of the members bought me a beautiful plant. It had gorgeous colors. It was a type of flower that I covet and love when I see it in someone's yard. I thanked the giver with all my heart and promised to take very good care of it. I mentioned that in my new office, I already had a little patio that maybe I could plant it. It might find a happy home in my new church. So that was about 3 weeks ago, and guess what? Yes, I have somehow already, I think, I hope not, but maybe, have killed that plant. I think in my defense, unless you're close to me, you'll know that plants are not good for me. I want to encourage all of you, if you were thinking about getting me a nice plant for my office, please don't. Unless you have time to come down and take care of it during the week and water it. Because plants and I, for some reason, don't mix. The green thumb and The Tannheimer home is my beloved Jim. He seems to just have that knack with plants. They just seem to love him. I don't know, but, and this is a goal, and it may never happen like some goals, but when I finally do retire, I'd love to have a garden of some sort, even a small one, that I could maybe practice and learn how to grow things. So the reason I share this is because the parable that we're reading and the parables that we'll be reading over the next 3 weeks all talk about planting and sowing and reaping the harvest. Jesus, using illustrations of the harvest and the effect of soil and the weeds and the ground, all of that. Remember, he's speaking to a culture of people very different than our culture today. So the parables about planting and sowing and reaping would have made sense to the people of Jesus' time. But in the year 2020, agricultural isn't the primary way that we live. It isn't typically how we grow our food. We're truly blessed, though, that in the last 50 years, even just recently, the area that we live in was almost 100% agricultural. There's a legacy here in La Habra of hard work and tending the soil as part of our legacy. I love that the Haas avocados were developed right here in La Habra Heights. I love that these hills were used for that purpose, and that the very house, the very land my house is built on, was citrus trees and orange trees until very shortly ago, in the middle of the last century. So some of you may have grown up on a farm. Maybe you helped your parents or grandparents work on the farm. Maybe you worked yourself there. Maybe you were even raised here in La Habra and were part of that. I was always fun to remember that even still today at La Habra High School, there's a very active 4-H program. So some of you, the planting and sowing, reaping and harvesting might be familiar. But I think in our current years, in our current time that we live, it's not as familiar. But I thank God every day that they're not depending on me to be the one to grow the food, because unfortunately, in my house, we would probably not have too much to eat. But Jesus uses illustrations, and he's the perfect preacher, right? He's the one who understands what people need to hear and what exactly the audience is that he's speaking to. So I've reflected on these texts for a while, and as I've been praying and thinking about them, something kind of jumped out at me. And I will confess, as a preacher, as a seminarian, all the years that I've read scripture, every single time I read a scripture again, something new always comes forth. I guess that's why it truly is the living word, because it's alive and it meets us where we need to be in that moment. And so I'm hoping that if you've got a Bible handy, if you're at home, maybe there's just a few of you here, get a Bible and let's look at Matthew chapter 13. I want you to look specifically at verse 19 of chapter 13. Jesus is clear here. He's explaining to the reader what this parable meant. The parables were meant to make people think. They were stories and they were real life situations that allowed the people and the hearers of the time to understand in a deeper way what it was that he was trying to share with them. But in verse 19, he says something so interesting that startled me a little this time when I read it. He said, "When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart." And I started thinking about sown in my heart. That's different than being sown in the ground. Now, I know in this parable, the analogy is that the soil is us and the seed is the word and God is the planter. But it hadn't occurred to me that things take root in our heart. That was a new idea. And maybe for you, that was something obvious. But I started thinking about the nature of God. What is he? God is love. Everything about his nature tells us that he loves us. Everything in scripture reminds us that we are loved. And without love, God cannot truly live in our lives. We must love him, and he must love us. So the heart is the logical place for that word to be planted. Not in our minds, not in our intellect. Those are important. We do need to understand intellectually what this says. But we need to understand spiritually and emotionally what the Word of God means for us. So we talk about our hearts and whether they're ready for the Word. Jesus talks about the hard ground, the hard heart. He talks about the shallow ground, the rocky ground, the ground that isn't able to really receive the seed, but it does for a short time, but then it fails because it's not deep enough. He talks about the thorny ground, full of other weeds and things that would distract and crowd out. And finally, he talks about good ground, a good heart. So the questions today that this raises for us are important. Is our heart hard? Is our heart like that stony path that the seeds fall on and nothing takes root? Are our hearts so closed and so broken that we cannot receive this word? How about having a little bit of a rocky heart? Maybe we're okay to love here and there. We love our friends, we love our family, we love the people that love us. But are we open to allowing a deeper love, a deeper feeling of God's word to come in and change us and transform us and mold our hearts? Then we talk about a sort of a thorny heart, right? Thorny ground, a thorny heart. And to me, when I visualize that, I visualize a heart that's full of stuff. Maybe not the things that God would have us be full of. Maybe we're achieving careers or resources. Maybe we're building empires in our life in some way or another. Maybe we have hobbies that distract us. Maybe friends or family or other things distract us. And so there's not room in our heart for God. He wants nothing more than to come and move in and live in our hearts through his word. And finally, I think about the good soil, the open heart, the heart that's ready to receive his word. And when it's received in our hearts, it blooms and blossoms into love, kindness, and ministry. God wants to change our hearts, brothers and sisters. He wants us to be renewed. And changing our hearts is the beginning. Sometimes our hearts have to break, and maybe that's the journey of all of these other types of soil. Maybe we have to work through the hardness of heart and the brokenness of heart and the crowdedness of our heart to finally be in a place where our hearts are open. Jesus is extravagant in his love. He talks in this parable about how the sower goes out and throws the seed liberally. You can imagine Jesus just throwing his love, throwing his word out to us to receive it. But if we're closed, how will we ever receive it? If our hearts are guarded or broken, how will we ever receive that seed of love? It's interesting when you think about how much God loves us. Each and every day we read in his word about that love. You know, it's interesting, even in the agricultural world, farmers don't just plant the seeds and walk away. They have to tend it. They have to love it. They have to water and nurture it. Jesus is this faithful planter. He wants us to feel and understand that he's there for us every day. Later in the Gospel of Luke, he describes himself as the vine dresser. He pleads for an unproductive world. He wants the vine to grow. He wants us to be full and flourishing to produce good fruit. Jesus doesn't plant seeds of faith and then just disappear. But instead, he is there for us every day. He's there for the long haul. He's willing to work through this journey of our hearts being hard and our hearts being broken and our hearts being crowded with other things in order to love us. He's willing to walk alongside us each and every day through this journey of our lives. And in each and every one of those seasons, he is there with his word. The word changes. I wonder if in my own life, my heart needed a little more nudging, which is why it stood out for me this time, this way. Jesus is a faithful good shepherd. He never gives up on us. He loves us each and every moment and every day. Into our hearts, he will come if we're ready to receive him. So, homework assignment. What's the situation with your heart? Which one of those categories that we listed, which type of soil are you? Where are you on that continuum? And, you know, it can change from day to day, I'm sure. Like all other parts of our human experience, there are good days and bad days. There are days where our hearts are open and full of love, and there are days where we're not so open, not so willing, not so able. And Jesus knows that too. He says, I'll never leave you or forsake you. I will be with you at every stage of that journey. But I encourage you this week, take a temperature of yourself. How are you doing? Is your heart open or is your heart crowded? Are there many things in your life that are distracting you from your relationship with Jesus? Or are you ready to receive him? Are you ready to have him partner with you in this journey of your life? Our hearts need to be ready for his word so that we might have life in his name, living our lives abundantly, completely, so that the world will know his saving grace. Amen. Gracious God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that through nature and through word and through song, you remind us each and every day of your love. Lord, let our hearts be open. Let our hearts be fertile ground for your word so that we might be transformed in your love. Gracious God, bless us now. Bless this congregation. Bless all that are listening. Hold them close and let them feel forever in their spirit, your Holy Spirit upon them. Lord, if in this moment they have never really received you or given themselves over to you, I ask now that you come into their lives, into their heart in a powerful way and show them your love, your transformative grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're so grateful you were here with us this morning. We're so happy to be able to share, even in this time of separation, the love of Jesus. I encourage you now, go into the world, check and see how you can help. May we be blessed and may we be a blessing. And now in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, may you go from your homes into the world safely with social distance and a mask, but be blessed and be a blessing to all that you encounter. In Jesus' name, amen.